Hello boys and girls. In this video I will engage in a little bit of internet math meme culture, and I'm going to talk about and elaborate on the infamous fraction minus 1 over 12 and explain why it pops up, why it is what it is. I give some context, some you know, not just analytic number theory math where it is important. We will start out with a hands-on proof of this claim here. I will come to that in a second. And otherwise, I will talk about the Riemann zeta function a little bit. I will talk about operators as they pop up in quantum mechanics, where these things go together. That is also related to Lie algebras and Lie groups. So in the video 2 days ago and 1 week ago, I talked about you know, derivations and group symmetries, all these things. So this relates. I will not say too much about these topics. I will stick to like practical series expansion proofs, so that people like learn to love, I guess, the Bernoulli numbers. This is a major part of this video, and have a feeling for why it's sort of natural that you have the number 12 there. So to spoil a little bit, in matrix theory and Lie groups, so you have this number popping up, and here's an example from algebraic topology. We will see that they kind of have the same origin. It's all about the Bernoulli numbers, and this is also the way in which they enter into the Riemann zeta function with the infamous value here at -1, 1 over 12. Or we will see how this 6 here at the value 2 is in a sense the same as the factor 6 of this number 12 here. What do I have here? So this is this, you know, this is the meme sum, let's say, and we will talk about Ramanujan summation. I think here is also a comment on that. Yeah, we will see how that emerges. So here you have the Bernoulli numbers, and we will like in passing also cover other sums because that's natural. But okay, so without further ado, let's jump into the really hands-on calculation where you see it popping up naturally the first time. So what I do here is I start with defining this sort of deformation, if you will, of a natural number. So this is the natural number times parameter q. You can think of q as a complex number. You can think of it as a number between 0 and 1. For the most cases, this would be the most practical way to start. And it's clear that if you multiply n by q to the power of n, then if you let q go to 1, then this just is n times 1 to the power of n. So this is just n. Sorry. And then let's consider this difference here. So the first part of the video will all be about the difference between sum and integral. And then we also go over to a more generalized, what's the difference between an infinitesimal operation and the discrete full step counterpart. So this will be a topic. So let's look at this. This is the sum over this expression. It's clear that if we were to just compute that, we will get some function in Q. We will see explicitly what it is. And if we let q go to 1, then we'll have the sum over all natural numbers, and that will diverge in the classical analytic theory, of course. But what about if we take this form of the summands, you know, this expression as sequence, and instead of doing the sum, the infinite sum over it, we do an unbounded integral. Well, you can probably guess that if q is 1, then this will also diverge as an integral. But here we look at the difference. We subtract the two notions of summing things together. We have the discrete sum, and then we have the integral. And the claim is that actually, if with this expression, whatever function that is, if we let q go to 1, then this number pops up, and it's you know, not just some random number, but it's this number that also pops up in Lie group theory, say. And this picture is a kind of spoiler. So here we have all these expressions as functions. So if we do this sum, we will see that we get some nice function at least between 0 and 1 when q is between 0 and 1. And that is actually the blue function. And this integral will also give more or less nice function. It's a little bit less nice. You see the behavior here at 0. It's like a very steep slope. And both of these functions indeed diverge when we go with q to 1, right? But in fact, they behave such that if you look at the difference, if you take the smaller one, the blue one, and subtract the red one, then you know there's a difference between them. So there's some, at least here it's obvious, there's some finite difference. And this claim is that the difference remains finite even if we go with q to the value 1. And this negative value here is exactly minus 1 over 12. So here's this claim again. That's what we are going to prove. Before we jump into that, it's actually like pretty elementary. But before we jump into the proof, I want to point out that we might guess the number if there's like a finite value at all. If the difference at q equals 1 is a finite value at all, then we can actually guess what that might be. The pool of like rational numbers that might be obtained there by looking at the Euler-Maclaurin, probably pronounce these word names different in English, but I say Euler. If you look at the Euler-Maclaurin formula, then we can hope that the numbers involved there reflect on these infinite sums and infinite integrals, and indeed that will turn out to be the case. So before I go into the proof of this difference being minus 1 over 12, I will look at the Euler-Maclaurin formula. And if you have never seen that, then this alone will give you a kind of feeling that this number, this fraction, is actually something that's omnipresent in math. So what is that? I will quickly look at the Wikipedia page before I go back to this page. So this has a lengthy Wikipedia entry. This is really an old formula that relates sums and integrals. So here we have a sum over a function, an expression, evaluated at discrete natural numbers. And here we have it, the same function, they're taking the integral over. And we see that if you look at the difference, then we get some fixed formula for what the difference is here. And the nice thing about this is that if f is well behaved, if it's like a polynomial, then the error term and everything that's on the right hand side of this formula will eventually become zero, because here are derivatives involved, and then we can do hands-on computation, what is actually the difference between an integral and a sum. So we will look at this formula here, the second version. And the claim is that if we sum over it starting at m plus 1 to n, then this is the same as integrating over it. So then the values in between are also like integrated over, like this. You can think of this as like an evaluation at grid points, and this is also an elevation in between. And of course, there are some regularity conditions on which functions we can take there. Our first example will be a polynomial, in fact, a monomial. And then there are some difference, some error, and this is just taking derivatives, plugging numbers into that, and also evaluating Bernoulli numbers, and we will come to the Bernoulli numbers then in a second and actually see how, like, we talk about the generating function and all of these things. So here again is the formula. The sum is the the integral plus some rest term, and the rest term starts out like that. So minus 1/2, and then the difference on these bounding values. And then also the first derivative, and here we have this first time that this 1 over 12 pops up, right? In the formula that we just saw, this is related to the second Bernoulli number. And this goes on and on and on and so on forth. And so there are higher derivatives on the right-hand side. So let's actually give an example. So I want to emphasize that we are here like in a discrete domain, right? In this example, before we go to it, I actually think that we want to prove, we talk about finite sums. And so let's start with some, you know, we can take any value you like. We'll take m equals 2, n equals 4, and then the function that we first consider is just this monomial n squared. The integral of this function is like 1 over 3 times n to the power 3 plus a constant. And so this formula claims that the sum, so the sum starting at n plus 1, so this is 3 to 4, so this is with this function 3 to the power of 2 plus 4 to the power of 2, that ought to be this integral. This is this, you know, this is this this expression evaluated at the upper bound 4 minus the lower bound 2, and then plus some rest terms, so minus 1/2, and here we plug in these values. The lower bound is 2, the upper bound is 4, and then minus 12, and take the derivative, so 2 comes down, 2, 4. So you can evaluate that, and you will see, okay, this is actually 25, and indeed the right-hand side is also 25. So this is, you can check it with a calculator. This is kind of the first hint. Hey, there is now like a scheme to create an infinite amount of formulas, right? You can take other functions here as well, and they will all say something about this 1 over 12, actually. You know, you can go, like, I don't have so much space here, but you can go with n to 80, and you can take a huge monomial here, and then you will get some formula that says, oh, the sum or the values to some powers is this formula. And it doesn't only work for monomials, it works for general polynomials and more and so on and so forth. And I do a second example here. So here we have m equals 2 and n to up to 7 even, but we take a more like not so steep function, we take just n. Then the integral is 1/2 n squared. And so the claim is that if we sum them up, so, you know, if we take the sum here, then this is 3 plus 4 plus 5, 6, 7, all this summed up equals whatever this is. Right, this is first the integral here, and then this term is already 0, so we just have this term, plugged it in, and you can try it out, and it works out. So in fact, what we compute here is actually just this formula, right? So this kind of says, the formula for this, for f of n is equals n, just says that, hey, to compute this sum, to compute this thing, you integrate it, that's where n squared comes in, and then the rest term is basically this extra n. There are a million ways to prove this claim. There are some very nice graphical elementary proofs of that, as well. And this is also like a very, like, bazooka on mosquito kind of way to prove that. But in this case, this just says that the sum is this integral, this n squared is integral, and the rest term happens to be then this expression. So you might notice that this is all finite sums. We go to a fixed n, and if we go with n to infinity, like if we were to consider the sum, then this will diverge. So the just using this formula as it is for infinite sum will not work. And spoiler, so if you look at something like Ramanujan summation, this is really basically this formula just with the problematic term just truncated, just, you know, Ramanujan says, basically just drop everything that goes to infinity, and then you get some result. And this is how then, for example, also how in Ramanujan summation this stays there. Okay, well, so this was of the finite examples. You can do some of those yourself. Now, we might ask, what happens if n goes to infinity, right? What happens with these undefined terms that these, like, you know, if this is not a bounded function, then what happens with the formula? Is there still some validity to the formula? Are there some aspects that remain true? And our example will show indeed these numbers, the Bernoulli numbers, still stay there exactly like they did here. And also, I want to point out at this point that, I mean, I don't want to get into a philosophical debate, but just to get some facts straight, it's not the case that from, let's say, piano arithmetic, you can prove that the infinite sum is diverges, because the notion of divergence needs a stronger theory. For example, if you have a metric on the real numbers, you know, if you introduce sets and infinite sets and so on and so forth, then you can speak about what an infinite sum ought to be. You know, there's some limit, and in this case, for example, for the meaning of this statement and sum over the sequence, like this series, is some limit value y. If that has a truth value, that means that this is basically stand-in for this claim, so that there is some number where the you know, the sequence of partial sums goes against this, and all this machinery, the real numbers, the metric, need more than just piano arithmetic. So I don't want to say it's non-trivial, but you cannot just from a few axioms prove that these kind of sums to which the theory doesn't assign a value attains a particular value. Okay, so let's now go to a proof of the difference with the infinite sums in unbounded integrals, right? So I will really start at the basics. The first thing is I show the geometric series, and then kind of the analogous version of the geometric series with the unbounded integral. So what do we have here? Okay, so we assume we have a complex number with absolute value smaller than one. Let's say it can also be a real number, you know, the value is between 0 and 1, say. And the first thing is that we can evaluate what this finite sum is, right? If you stare at it for a second, then you will see that this claim is true. So here we have q minus 1 multiplied by the sums of powers of q. That is q minus 1. And here I wrote down all the summands, so that n equals 0 is 1, n equals 1 becomes q, then q squared, and so on and so forth. The last one is q to the power of capital N. And if you multiply these out, well, then you get a lot of cancellations. And the only thing that remains is the top one, the first one. So that's q to the power of n plus 1. And the last one is just minus 1. Everything else like has a pairwise cancellation. So we have that. And now if we let n go, like this formula holds for all finite n. If we let n go to infinity and q is some value between, let's say, absolute value smaller than 1, or let's say some number between 0 and 1, some real one, then, for example, 1/3, and 1/3 to a huge power is something super small. So this expression vanishes, so we get that this sum is 1 over minus this thing. So this is just a geometric series, right? We have just shown that the series expansion of 1 over 1 minus q is this thing. Sorry if the, like, that should be obvious, or that it might be obvious to the most people, but let's say I want to be like explicit. Now some other expression, the analog here. This is not an finite sum, but a finite integral, like a bounded integral. like the upper bound is some number. What is that? Multiplied by the analog of q minus 1 here is the logarithm of q. First we do a trick. We say q to the power of n is e to the power of logarithm of q to the power of n. Then we use, you know, we just use exponential and logarithm properties. The n comes down. Then what is the integral of this with respect to n? Well, it's easier to think in the other direction. If we would take the derivative, then the logarithm would come down. If you take the integral, then what comes down is 1 over the log. So the log after the integral cancels with this log. And the upper bound is as capital N, and the lower bound is 0. E to the power of 0 is minus 1. So that's that. This is basically the equivalent to this. You know, there's just an integral. So we're in a kind of in the analytical world, and suddenly we introduce this exponential function. And so for q between let's say a real number between 0 and 1, the logarithm there is negative. You know, the logarithm starts out for a very small real numbers, positive real numbers at minus infinity goes up. At q equals 1, the logarithm is 0, and then it slowly rises. So in the interval that we fixed here, for reals in any case, this is negative. So if we let go n to infinity, similarly, this term vanishes just like this one. You know, this is really also just, we could put the n again into the logarithm and do the limit then. So similar to what we had here, we see that the integral over this expression is minus 1 over the logarithm of q. This is really the analog to this one. And this is also that, but we're not going to use this one. Okay, now for something that might look arbitrary at first, this is just to help us doing the series expansion by hand. So let's say q is 1 half of times x and then 1 third x squared. Then y plus y squared, you can do that in, you know, by hand. You get that this term is just from here, and then we get if we square the y, then we get also another x squared term. So we have minus 1/3, and then plus and 1/2 squared, and this term, and everything else is bigger. And so here, you know, if you compute that minus 1/3 plus 1/4, then you get minus 12, so this will be relevant, obviously. Okay, and then I will now like I go over this very quickly, but you can look up the series expansion of the logarithm. This is basically the defining property of the logarithm, right? This is the integral over 1 over the argument. Some substitution of integral variables, and you get that this is this series expansion. So this is just a basic series expansion of the logarithm, no magic here. And then if you want to compute the series expansion of 1 over the log that we are going to need here, then this is 1 over this expression. We have 1 over x, this is this x. And then the series here starts out like this. And we can again use now the geometric series, right? We put this together, this as one expression. This was our y basically, and we have already computed that, right? This is this expression plus this expression squared according to the geometric series, and so this is just that. So this is, you can also plug that into Wolfram Alpha and do the series expansion of that, and you will see, oh, if I look at 1 over logarithm 1 plus x, then we have this expression, and here we have this 1/2 and the minus 1/12. So might become interesting. So let's look at the difference here. So we have seen that this is the geometric series. So this is 1 over 1 minus q. We have seen this is integral here, is this logarithm, and the logarithm expands like that. So if you now plug in for x q minus 1, then the this term cancels. You know, this is exactly the divergence of 1 over log q, and what is left is this. And so if you take then this expression that we want to look at, actually, this is just the derivative of that expression, right? Both of these are linear, and we want these n's to come up, down. And so we multiply by q and take the derivative. And this is like taking the derivative of this expression, and what's left is minus 1 over 12. So this was this proof. If you have concerns regarding switching the integral and derivative sign here, just if you're not so sure about that, you could also say that, okay, instead of this integral, we directly use the result, the 1 over log. So if you take the derivative of that thing, then this is 1 over the logarithm of q squared. This is basically the counter term that prevents this expression, if you subtract it, from diverging at q equals 1. Okay, let me shortly check something here. Okay. Good. So now we have seen that these numbers come into play, and we have seen now this 1 over minus 1, 1 over 12 emerging, but we will now go a little bit deeper and crystallize out how the Bernoulli numbers relate to that, and the Bernoulli numbers and the exponential function and so on and so forth. So this section is also again doing series expansions, but more abstractly, more generally. So we are done with this one example. So let's consider some function f that has is analytic, has a Taylor expansion like that, series expansion. We want to normalize, like just for the sake of it, normalize to functions that are which at zero have the value 1. What I do here is I do a kind of I want to consider 1 over this f in the similar way that we took the logarithm, and I want the resulting function to be normalized. And so what I do here is I define this q, which is 1 over f, except I also multiply the argument by this result, this f of 0. And this has the effect that if I plug in 0, then I have just f of 0 divided by f of 0, and this is normalized. This is just one trick to have more general functions applicable there. And now I ask, similar to this logarithm, what is actually 1 over this function for which I know the series expansion, right? For the logarithm, we knew what the series expansion were, or we calculated it, and then we had to do the inverse. And so if you play the same game with this function f that has a series expansion, then you get the following. You can divide this a0, and then use the geometric series as we did before, and then you get this kind of combination of terms. So you can also look up on the Wikipedia page for the formal power series, and you have a lot of this kind of how do you get to the 1 over the function or the inverted function, and all how the coefficients of this kind of power series and analytic function translate if you do any operations on them. And the thing to take away here is that if the function f is basically in any way related to the exponential function, if the function has all this 1 over faculty of some number, right? The exponential function is 1 over 1 faculty plus 1 over 2 faculty, 1 over 3 faculty, and so on and so forth, then here in the second term, in the first term, basically you get this 1/2, and in the second term the 3 comes in. And so suddenly you have a combination of 2s and 3s, and that's always where the 12 emerges. Because the 12 is just 2 times 2 times 3. And so if you do kind of this inversion games with series, if you compare objects, that's what we will do in the next section, then for particular functions, d12 is introduced, and now the only question left is why is the exponential function so prevalent in these kind of topics? Why is the exponential function so relevant when we talk about differences between discrete and analytic? You know, in this sum minus integral, we had this difference. What is the difference between the evaluation everywhere and the evaluation just on grid points? And the Riemann zeta function is like, you can see it as on the grid points are there some just sum of fractions, but then the analytic comes in when you do the analytic continuation of the function and so on, and we will see some other examples. Or if you if you go from the Lie algebra, which is kind of the representation of the group at one, like there's everything small, and then you go to full step, like full rotations, full group operations. This is these transitions from the infinitesimal to the finite, to the completed. Let's go on with that. So let's consider this particular series. So this is just the exponential function, except the coefficients are shifted by one. So exponential function is one plus and so on and so forth. I remove the constant term, but then I divide by q again. So I get another kind of exponential function, just the coefficient is shifted by one. Then by this logic, one over this function, like if I invert this function, if I write one over fq, then from this general formula, we can read off that, coefficients must pop up again, right? Because the exponential function is exactly the one which has 1 over 2 faculty, 1 over 3 faculty, and this combination exactly leads to that. This is similar to what we have with the logarithm. The logarithm and the exponential function are inverted to another, and so the coefficients also relate to each other. But this is how that pops up, and these numbers here, these are exactly the Bernoulli numbers. So this is the generating function for the Bernoulli numbers. Here I have this note that if you add another exponential function, then you get actually Bernoulli polynomials, but they are not really of interest to us here. So let's quickly check out the site for the Bernoulli numbers. So, you know, they start out here with, depending on the convention, plus minus 1/2, then 1 over 6, and so on and so forth. And here we already have this kind of expressions, right? This is already looking close to Riemann zeta function. And you know what Bernoulli did here, which is the formula that I'm interested in. Yeah, here you have the claim that generating function is exactly this function that I just considered. So we kind of now shifted the problem to, okay, we know that the difference between integrals and sums is something with Bernoulli numbers, and the Bernoulli numbers somehow relate, are some defined by this exponential, the exponential. So the question that remains now is, why does the exponential come into the picture in the first place, right? So this is what the next section here is going to be, so to connect the dots kind of. Okay, and so this is the section on Euler and Lagrange. Yeah, so let's I introduce a notation here for taking the derivative. I write a capital DH, and what is this expression? Well, if you choose any point x, there's some function, you choose one point x that you're interested in, and then you linearize the function at that point. What do you do? Well, you take the derivative, you get the slope, and then if you are interested in how does the function evolve there, in an approximate sense, but then you take the slope and do one step, like one step, a small step h, let's say, right? So this is kind of this is just the approximation to the next value. And we might ask, and here the question of infinitesimal versus complete finite movement continuum. Sorry. How does the approximation in general, and this is also the relation between the Lie algebra, right? The Lie algebra is the approximation to the full group operation. How does the infinitesimal step, the linearization, compare to actually taking the whole step? What is the difference there? So the to compute the whole step, the Greek delta here, we need to take a full step, which by Taylor expansion is just this expression, where dh to the power of k means like taking k derivatives. And the full step, the actual difference between the function at a point x plus h, a little further away, minus the whatever function has the value here, this is the full difference. And we are now going to be interested in comparing the infinitesimal change in f value with the completed actual delta. Just as a side note, what we see here is like if you consider this is an operator space, or if you have, let's start with some vector space of functions, and then you look at the operators on it, then you can consider this just a standalone operator on an operator algebra, and then something like the exponential on it is defined. So this relates on the one hand to the operator algebra as I discussed it in the video a week ago, and here I also have the shift operator. So this is exactly what we do here. Here they actually use this notation, for example, and here's where the name Lagrange comes in as well. And you know, from here, this is how it kind of relates to quantum mechanics. I couldn't go to momentum operator. Then we see this is the operator with a small change in energy direction, if you will. And this is also then, like if you look at the commuting relations, this is how the Lie algebra stuff comes in. This is how the Weyl algebra stuff comes in that I talked about in last week. But okay, let's not make it too complicated here. So let's compare the finite step and the infinitesimal step. And let's compare it by taking the quotient. What is the relative change as a ratio between the two? Well, okay, let me just browse it up again. We had here that the finite step is, the zeroth approximation cancels here. The first approximation is this. I highlighted this. And then we have the second order derivatives. And so if you divide that by this expression, then we get this cancels out, 1 plus, and then we have here 1 over the first approximation plus times this term. And now we're interested in actually flipping it around. Now we're interested in this infinitesimal change divided by the full change. And now the series expansion, as we just discussed it abstractly, comes in, right? So this results exactly in these expressions. Why do we have 4 here and why do we have 6 here? Well, exactly because this delta operator is an exponential. So 1 over exponential of d minus 1, that is exactly this expression. This is exactly how the Euler numbers come into play. This is literally the generating function of the Euler number, except here the value is not this parameter q, but it's these differential operators. But as a series in one direction in the operator space, the operator commutes with itself. So this has the same coefficients. So we see now that if we compare something infinitesimal and something full, like the full step, then naturally, if we write one thing on the left-hand side and on the one side and one on the other side, then naturally this Taylor coefficient, they lurk kind of in the background as these functions of operators go. Okay, and so yeah, I mean, here you already see it, like if we were to use any function, then this coefficients would like mix up and you would not recognize the minus 1 over 12 there. But if you have some monomials, then you get this 2 and 3 coefficients. Okay, and so now let's tie this back to the Riemann zeta function and how this relates to Bernoulli. You might know the gamma function, which is like the factorial, but interpolated also for values that are not integers and not positive numbers, positive natural numbers. So this is literally just defined like that, and this is done so in a way that if you write, you know, gamma of s plus 1, then the integrand is exactly set up in a way that the defining relations of the gamma function is fulfilled. Well, let me actually, for completeness. Yeah, so this is the property that we want on the natural numbers. It's defined like that, and that works out so that if you shift it by one, then you get exactly the gamma function times the argument again. If you read the old Riemann paper, which is my favorite paper ever, there are some awesome tricks with related to Mellin transform, where he gets, you know, counting of primes with it back into the analytic theory, and that's how analytic number theory starts. Interestingly enough, this is, I think, the only paper Riemann ever wrote about number theory, and it's kind of spin off a new subject. What is easy to do is relating the gamma function to the zeta function as it is defined, because we take this t and we do now substitution. We say t equals n times x, right? And we get here an n times x, and here an n times x, and here an n times x. Then we get n to the power of s minus 1, and then we get here an n, so this minus 1 cancels. And here is then the exponential function e to the power of minus nx. And if you then define the zeta function on the positive numbers like that, well, then you can easily express that using the gamma function. Then you just have a sum over whatever comes out here. And if you do if you use the geometric series again, right? So the sum over all z to the power of n, sum over all n, and z in this case is e to the power of minus x, then you get 1 over what this expression here, right? So not sure if that explained it like is enough to follow, but if you start with this here and if you start with this here, then you can get this here very easily. And what have we here? I mean, this is the generating function basically for the Bernoulli numbers, except there is a higher power there and we take the integral over it. But it's not far-fetched to assume that this somehow relates to the Bernoulli numbers, I guess, right? So for example, as this holds, we have that zeta at 2, this is one plus 1/4 plus 1/9 and so on and so forth. This would be like, if you plug in s equals 2, gamma of 2 is just 1. Here we have x to the power of 1. Then we have this expression. We know already how to like expand that in terms of Bernoulli numbers and the integral over it. And this is some number. And it turns out if you look at positive even numbers, then you get this relation. Then all the positive numbers, if you plug in an positive even number here, then you get some fraction times some Bernoulli number, which should not be too surprising, because this the zeta function is basically hung up already on zeta on Bernoulli number values. It's just how the monomial kind of moves between these values. And so, for example, if you plug in n in this formula, n equals 1, then we have this goes away. This is 4 pi squared divided by 2 times 2 times 2 faculty. So the 2s exactly cancel, and you're left with pi squared. And this b2, what is b2? Well, this is the Bernoulli number 2, which was 1/6. And so this is the answer to the Basel problem if you already have this zeta function at hand. And then this, like, For the sum, this is not so obvious, but if you have other representations of the zeta function, then you can do the analytic continuation, which means that you move along the complex plane where everything oscillates highly. You have e to the power of I times something. A lot of terms cancel. It's very safe to go along there. You can go with the zeta function to the other side. And it turns out that you have this this famous zeta function reflection formula where it says, oh, the values on the back side relate to the back, the like on the negative, for example, complex plane relate to the one on the positive. Complex plane, positive and negative in terms of real numbers, somehow with some oscillatory term, and this is this sign here, and then some overhead. And here we can then now see, oh, we can relate then some negative numbers also to these positive numbers, so the uneven negative real numbers can be related to the positive ones. With the reflection formula, and easily we see here, if we plug in s equals minus 1, then we have here 2 times 1 over 2 pi to the power of 2, similar to here, our calculation here, then sine of minus pi half, that should be minus 1, and gamma of 2 is again 1, and you see here it's zeta function of the value 2. So this the pi's exactly cancel out with the values that we already know here. So what's left is one factor of 1/2 and this Bernoulli number here. And so we have in the end minus 1/12. And you see now that this minus 1/12 of the zeta function is really just 1/2 minus 1/2 of the Bernoulli number that is also on the positive side, right? This is literally, in a sense, the same 1/6. And whether or not it's plus or minus 12, it doesn't matter so much. It depends on which formula you write down and where you flip the sign. But so this is how this goes about. Obviously, I have not proven this. But this is just to tie it to this sum. Although we already know that this sums over powers relate to the Bernoulli numbers here, right? Through this formula, for example. It's, by the way, also not hard to, we had the logarithm before. If you have the powers of the inverse logarithm, then you can also calculate all these values and they relate to Bernoulli numbers and zeta functions. Okay, and I already talked about, I hinted at the relationship of the Bernoulli numbers and group theory. So the Baker-Kemper-Hausdorff formula is how you compute products of group elements in terms of the algebra elements that lead to the group. Why do we have this 12 minus 1/12 here? Well, for one, we already speak of an exponential function if we speak of the morphism between Lie algebra and Lie group, or the algebra matrix element and the matrix group element. But it's actually even more explicit here. If we scroll down a little bit, so this is exactly the numbers that we also had before. If you look at the proof of this formula, then you arrive at one point at this expression. So the exponential of the, let's say, a matrix times the exponential of the other matrix equals the exponential of this expression, if you just apply the exponential and get rid of the logarithm here. And what do we have here? Well, we have this at x is the joint representation of the element x acting on y, and then also this 1/1 minus exponential function of the minus the adjoint. This is just a placeholder for this series that is defined by that. And all this happens to be just the generating function of the Bernoulli numbers, basically. And this all goes together because the adjoint representation is literally a derivation. It's literally like the D operator that we had before with the series expansion. And if you look at the algebra. So if you look at the D algebra definition, then do we have a good definition here? No. Okay. Yeah, Kobe. So we have this bilinear antisymmetric operation that defines Lie algebra, and it's required to satisfy the Jacobi identity. And the Jacobi identity, I mean, this is boring here. This is exactly the product rule, right, for the derivative. And in that sense, the adjoint is a derivative to say that the algebra should satisfy with the Lie bracket, the Jacobi identity is literally postulating that I want to look at an algebra which has this derivative. And then the whole calculations that work for the normal algebraic operations also work in these abstract settings where you don't have some limits or so. You just work on the formal, in the formal setting. Comes back again to the Heisenberg Lie algebra that is in a way doubly related to derivations. And yeah, if you have the matrix exponential formula also linked, so this is just the same formula. And finally, the other example, this is now almost boring. Here we have the definition of the taught class in algebraic geometry, and the expression that we have here is again like it's literally just like the core of it is just a generating function of the Bernoulli numbers, and so that's how these things go together. Okay, I was tinkering how I should make this video, whether I should split it up and so on and so forth, but it was difficult, and eventually I decided to cover it all in one video. But I hope that after watching this, you are not afraid anymore of the number 1 over 12, 1 over minus 12. If it pops up, then you might know what this relates to. And yeah, I will not go too deep into the analytic sections again. I will rather follow the path on the algebra and group theory side of things. If you have any questions, then let me know in the comments. And if you want me to cover something more particular, then tell me as well. Take care.